You are listening to the Bible teaching ministry of Pastor Ross Graham of Grace Bible Church, Kingswood, New South Wales, Australia. Ross will be using the inerrant word of God to draw our truth in its original context. To find more messages like this, visit www.gracebiblechurchkingswood.org. Or to join our online community, you can now find us on Facebook by searching for Grace Bible Church, Kingswood. May this message today bless you, and as always, bring glory to God. Here's Pastor Ross.
Well, welcome to this service in your lounge room today. Someone said to me, how am I coping with the COVID lockdown? And I'm looking forward to a haircut, otherwise next week I really may have to wear a ponytail because the hair is getting just a fraction long. But look, just hang in there. We'll be back to worship as soon as we possibly can, I'm sure. I stand here today, some 40 years on in entry into the ministry, and I do so simply because along the way, somewhere, sometime, someplace, somebody made a sacrifice and they gave. They gave of their finances, they gave of their talent, they gave of their time, so that we could really continue on in this ministry. And that's not unusual with a lot of preachers throughout the world today. But I thought that we would start our time in the precious Word of God today, because the message today is entitled Behind the Scenes Giving. So I thought we'd start with a wonderful song by Ivan Parker, and please listen to it with great joy and reflect upon the words.
I went to heaven and you were there with me. We walked upon the streets of gold beside the crystal sea. We heard the angels singing. Did someone call your name? We turned and saw this young man. He was smiling as he came. He said, friend, you may not know me now. Then he said, but wait. You used to teach my Sunday school when I was only 8. Every week you would say a prayer before the class would start. And one day when you said that prayer, I asked Jesus in my heart. Thank you for giving to the Lord. I am a life that was changed. Thank you for giving to the Lord. I am so glad you gave. Then another man stood before you. He said, remember the time a missionary came to your church. His pictures made you cry. You didn't have much money, but you gave it anyway. Jesus took the gift you gave, that's why I'm here today. Thank you for giving to the Lord. I am a life that was changed. One by one they came, for as the eye could see, each life somehow touched by your generosity. Little things that you have done, sacrifices made, noticed here on earth, in heaven now proclaim. Listen, I know up in heaven you're not supposed to cry, but I am almost sure I saw tears in your eyes when Jesus took your hand and you stood before the Lord. He said, my child, look around you, for great is your reward. Sing it now. Thank you for giving to the Lord. I am alive, that's been changed. Every one of you here today, that you gave all that you had as you've touched the many lives along the way.
Can I begin today by simply saying this, that in the beginning, God put his hand into the unformed clay of creation. And what he did was he molded a universe. Light beamed into the darkness, the firmament burst forth like fireworks, the seas churned with life, the beast stretched and yawned in their new dawn, and man took his first breath in paradise. This is good, God sighed. He sighed with satisfaction after each stage of the work. But towards the end, though, he suddenly stopped. And he said, this is not good. And the angels gasped. Creation held its breath. What could be wrong? What on earth could be wrong with the good creation of God? Well, it's recorded in Genesis 2:18, and a verse that you're very familiar with, I'm sure. Because that scripture says, the Lord God said, it is not good for the man to be alone. I will make a helper suitable to him. Or for him. And lo and behold, the next thing you knew, there was Adam standing there with a rib missing, and he was looking at Eve because she stood in front of him. A perfect companion, we might say. And God stepped back, as it were, with a smile as broad as the blue sky, and he said, now, brushing off his hands, this is good. This is very good. You see, church, from the beginning, God designed people to be together. He meant for us to live in community as husband and wife, as family, as friends. And some may try, in the outliving of their lives, to wave the flag of indifference, saying, I'm my own person, I'm my own man, I'm my own woman, I don't need anybody whatsoever. But none of us can fully function in isolation. These past few weeks in lockdown with this COVID outbreak here in Sydney has shown us that we really need to have interaction with people, and so we get a little bit frustrated because we're isolated. No matter how talented, no matter how intelligent or capable we are, we need each other. That's very important. We need each other. And according to God's order of things and the precious word of God, everyone has a contribution to make for the good of the whole. Just think, for instance, of how many members of a church work together. The teachers, the technicians, the musicians who play the piano and the flute and the guitars and so on, the artists, the counselors, the craftsmen, the administrators. The list could go on and on and on. Now, to help us function together as one body, the Holy Spirit distributes various gifts. You need to understand that the distribution of gifts are given by the Holy Spirit. So let me show you that from Scripture, if I can, just momentarily. Take your Bibles and turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 12. We'll be looking at several passages of Scripture today, and we'll be honing in on Luke chapter 8, verses 1 through 3, which is our primary passage. But just let me show you from Scripture, 1 Corinthians 12, 4, if you would, how the Holy Spirit distributes gifts. And in the fourth verse of 1 Corinthians 12, we read this: there are many kinds of gifts, but the same Spirit. And then dropping down to verse 7, now to each one, the manifestation of the Spirit is given for the common good. That's very important to understand. Any gift of the Spirit is given for the common good, not for the good of just one person. Then verse 12, it says the body is a unit. And though it is made up of many parts, and though all its parts are many, they form one body. So it is with Christ. Dropping down to verse 14. Now the body is not made up of one part, but of many. And in the outliving of their Christian faith, some people question their value because they do not have more visible gifts. But Paul responds to that in verse 19 by saying this: if they were all one part, where would the body be? You see, in a body, and I need you to understand this, in a human body, the toes are just as important as the fingers. And in a church, those who work the cameras or do the flowers or hand the books out in the front foyer of the church or do the administration work or the Lord's Supper preparation are just as important as those who stand in front of them. Now, to be sure, let me say that God notices our unseen contributions. I have no doubt of that in terms of Matthew 10:42. Even a cup of cold water given in love will bring its divine compensation. And those who quietly sow and plant and water in others' lives, according to 1 Corinthians 3:8, will be rewarded according to their own labor. For Scripture says in Hebrews 6:10, one of my favorite verses, God is not unjust. Do you love that? God is not unjust. And he will not forget, the Scripture says, your work and the love that you have shown him as you have helped this people and you continue to help him. God is not unjust. He will reward every act of kindness, every gracious word, every bit of energy invested in his name. Let me tell you, God logs in his book to be paid out with dividends in heaven. Now, it's in the spirit of honoring the unseen heroes of the faith that as Dr. Luke writes under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, that he includes a special mention here in this section of the Word of God that we're about to look at. Special mention of Christ's key supporters at the beginning of chapter 8. So having turned you to 1 Corinthians 12, I'll have you just very quickly go back to our primary passage for today, and that is Luke chapter 8, the first three verses. Luke 8, first three verses. Good to see hear the little puffs of dust coming up in the confines of your lounge room there this morning as you flick the pages of your Bibles. And finding the eighth chapter of Luke, you need to understand that the chapter opens with Jesus and the disciples on the move. And in verse 1 of the passage, it says this: after this, Jesus traveled about from one town and village to another, proclaiming the good news of the kingdom of God, and the 12 were with him. perhaps no longer welcome and accepted in the synagogues, Jesus and the 12 had taken to the road full time to be with the people. The boats of the fishermen turned disciples rocked silently in their moorings by their little wharves. Their nets lay in storage, not being used. And closed signs hung in the windows of the other disciples' businesses. They were on their own now, without home, without income, and perhaps feeling like outcasts as they traveled from village to village and from town to town in the area of the Galilean area. The disciples must have had their concerns in this new venture. Where would their next meal come from, per se? Or where would they sleep when the nights get cold? And where would they find a place to lay their head? What if one of them got sick? What if their clothes wore out or their families back home needed help? What would happen to them? And I want to suggest to you as you study these portions of the precious Word of God, and they're very familiar to many of us, I'm sure, but it's easy to forget about the everyday needs that Jesus and his disciples had. You see, manna just didn't appear on the ground for their breakfast every single solitary morning. I can find no account of that in the gospel accounts. So the question arises, how did God provide? Well, Luke tells us the answer in the next two verses. Because also traveling with them, follow along in verses 2 and 3, were some women who had been cured of evil spirits and diseases. Mary called Magdalene, from whom 7 demons had come out, Joanna, the wife of Cusa, the manager of Herod's household, Susanna, and many others. These women were helping to support them out of their own means. Now, did you ever consider the fact, or did you know that Jesus traveled with more than just his disciples? Did you know that? You see, on this preaching tour through Galilee, he took with him not only the 12, but he took with him these three women whose names here are mentioned in the precious Word of God, and the scripture says many others who ministered to him and the disciples of their means. Now, whilst Jesus did not appoint any women apostles or place women in places of leadership, I want to suggest to you that he did lift the status of women and recognize their place of ministry. It seems to me, as I study this portion of the Word of God, it seems a whole team of sponsors like these women took care of their practical needs. Things like buying the food, supplying clothing, making special arrangements. And the question arises, why would they go to so much trouble in their following of Jesus? Well, let me tell you why. Because you see, Jesus changed their lives. His power embraced them, delivered them of demon possession or sickness, and had given them a second chance. Gratitude, you see, flowed out of their hearts in a steady stream of generosity and devotion to the Lord. So let's get to know these benefactors a little bit better in the precious Word today. Can we do that? First of all, there is a woman called Mary, called Magdalene. That is, she was from the town of Magdala, located on the western shore of the Sea of Galilee. And once possessed by 7 demons, she found release in the person of Jesus, and she found peace for her tortured soul. And in loving response to the way that Jesus had touched her life, she would cling to her Savior all the way to the cross and beyond, to his burial and to his empty tomb. The scripture records that. Second is Joanna. Her husband was a fellow by the name of Cusa, who, according to one biblical historian, was, and I quote, the official who looked after the king's financial interests. There could be no more trusted and important official. And I want to say to you that it is an interesting sideline indeed, because That historian goes on to say this. He says it is an amazing thing to find Mary Magdalene with the dark past and Joanna, the lady of the court, in the one company. Mary and Joanna, two women from different worlds, two women from totally different backgrounds, joining hand in their common devotion to the Lord Jesus. And they would even be at the tomb together, bowing before two dazzling angels who would announce that Christ had risen. And what a great message that is. Hallelujah. Christ is risen. The tomb is empty. The stone is rolled away. He's gone. Hallelujah. Third woman is Susanna. And this is the only place in all of Scripture that Susanna is mentioned. And Luke chooses not to tell us much about her, except that along with the rest, she was also, according to verse 3, she was also helping to support them out of her own means. Now, that phrase is translated from the Greek verb diakonao. And it means to minister. It means to serve. It means to wait upon. To do one a service, to care for one's needs. And the imperfect tense in the original text suggests continuous action. In other words, what I mean by that, I simply mean this, that these women were continually caring for the everyday needs of Jesus and the disciples, freeing them up a little bit so that they could proclaim the gospel, so that they could get about the business of proclaiming the message of the kingdom of God. And Luke also says that they served out of their own means. In other words, they made the personal sacrifices necessary to keep the ministry rolling along. What a debt we owe to these women and many other diakonos who gave their all to make Christ's ministry possible. Now, church, I need you to understand this, that many others have contributed to the needs of Christ and his church throughout history. And they too can serve as models of generosity for you and I who live in the church, the body of Christ of the 21st century. So let me give you four rarely remembered examples. And these, I believe, with respect to generosity, are dispensational truths. The same fact of generosity flows through every dispensation in the dealings of God with man. First of all, there is a man from Cyprus. It's beautiful to see how the gracious attitude of Christ's supporters spilled over like a river rushing towards a breathtaking waterfall into the young assembly of believers in Jerusalem who were struggling financially at many times. So I want you to turn from Luke 8 to Acts chapter 4. Find Acts chapter 4, if you would, in your Bibles. Acts chapter 4, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, Acts. Chapter 4, if you would, very quickly, and find the 32nd verse, and then I'll have you just follow along, if you would, in your copy of God's Word. Acts 4:32, all the believers were one in heart and mind. No one claimed that any of his possessions was his own, but they shared everything they had. With great power, the apostles continued to testify to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and much grace was with them all, rather. There were no needy persons among them. From time to time, those who owned lands or houses sold them and brought the money from the sales and put it at the apostles' feet, and it was distributed to anyone as he had need. Now, among the unselfish souls was one particular gracious man. And we read in verse 36 and following, Joseph, a Levite from Cyprus, whom the apostles called Barnabas, which means son of encouragement, sold a field he owned and brought the money and he put it at the apostles' feet. Now, let me just say to you here, this is in a context of giving behind the scenes and in the context of generosity. You see, Barnabas saw a need in that assembly. And he took one look at his own resources, what he had, and in a beautiful gesture of grace, he spontaneously gave. Second were the churches in Macedonia. You see, over in Macedonia, there lived a whole congregations of Barnabases. But these generous believers, however, had none of his assets. So let me just show you that. Turn to 2 Corinthians, if you would. 2 Corinthians chapter 8. Just find 2 Corinthians chapter 8, if you would. First verse, and follow along. And now, brothers, Paul says, we want you to know about the grace that God has given the Macedonian churches. Out of the most severe trial, their overflowing joy and their extreme poverty welled up in rich generosity. For I testify that they gave as much as they were able, and even beyond their ability, entirely on their own. And they urgently pleaded with us for the privilege of sharing in this service to the saints. That would be the saints or the believers in Jerusalem. And their giving, let me say, surprised even the great apostle of grace. Look, verse 5, Paul says this, and they did not do as we expected. They didn't do as we expected. And that raises the question in my thinking, what was the secret of such overflowing liberality? Well, the verse continues. Verse 5, the end of the verse. But they gave themselves first to the Lord, and then to us in keeping with God's will. You see, by giving our hearts to the Lord who gave his life for us, we prepare a seedbed where generosity can grow, where generosity can flow, where generosity can flourish, reaching out to others with generosity. Thirdly, were the believers in Philippi. Some ordinary believers supported Paul in Philippi when no one else would. And in his letter to the Philippians, the Apostle Paul acknowledged that. So just let me show you that. Philippians chapter 4. A little bit of turning today, but that's all right. It's good exercise. You haven't been getting much exercise during the COVID pandemic, so this will give you a little bit of extra exercise in the arms at least, and the hands at least. So turn to Philippians, if you would, chapter 4. Because he acknowledged the fact that believers supported Paul when no one else would. Look what it says, verse 15. Moreover, as you Philippians know, in the early days of your acquaintance with the gospel, when I set out from Macedonia, not one church shared with me in respect to giving and receiving except you only. And they gave to Paul regularly. It wasn't just a one-off thing. Look at that in the latter part of the 16th verse. He says, you sent me aid, listen, again and again when I was in need. And according to the scripture, verse 18, their offerings were a fragrant offering, an acceptable sacrifice, listen, pleasing to God. See, Paul was glad, church, about their generosity, not for his sake, no, but for their sake. You see, they were the ones who would someday receive the Lord's reward. And he said that in the latter part of the 17th verse. He said, I am looking for what may be credited to your account. And then fourthly, there is instruction on Crete, the island of Crete. One of Paul's apprentices named Titus, who ministered on the island of Crete, a very difficult place to minister, received this advice from the aging gray-haired apostle. Let me just read to you what he told Titus from Titus 3:14. He says this, our people must learn to devote themselves to doing what is good, in order that they may provide for daily necessities and not live unproductive lives. Let me read that verse for you again. Our people must learn to devote themselves to doing what is good in order that they may provide for daily necessities and not live unproductive lives. Now, let me be very honest with you here today. For fear of abuse and fear of criticism, some Christian leaders hesitate to talk about the legitimate needs, key word, legitimate needs of ministry. And I'll not belabor the point here today, because you know me better than that when it comes to this whole issue of financial giving and giving of yourself and talents and time to God. But in order to experience the joy of giving, Christians, listen to me, must know the facts. They must know the facts. And certainly it is absolutely wrong to manipulate people into giving like some of the slick TV evangelists do when they make their appeals for every single solitary book and thing that they produce. But it doesn't mean we should shy away from making people aware of ministry opportunities. This verse also reminds us that besides financial giving, the donating of your time and the donating of your talents are ways to meet others' needs, and you can do that spiritually. You see, when you donate your time and your talents, you minister to other people within the body of Christ. So let me close today with three much-needed reminders. The example of the women who supported Jesus, the early believers, the early assembly at Jerusalem, and the Macedonian believers, and the Christians at Philippi, and the Christians at Crete, all add up to a bottom line principle, this bottom line principle. Let me give it to you very, very clearly. Everyone is important in the Lord's work. Let me give that to you again. Everyone is important in the Lord's work. That means you. The church is a body in which every individual member is essential. Every single solitary member, saved by the precious blood and kept by the power of Christ, is essential in the work of the local assembly. So, have you been giving of yourself to meet the needs of others in spiritual service? If you'd like to contribute more, here are a few reminders to help you follow the examples of the men and women we've just met in the scriptures. Firstly, since all of our resources are God's anyway, when it comes to how we spend them, His work deserves the very top priority. Let me give that to you again. Since all our resources are God's anyway, when it comes to how we spend them, His work deserves the very top priority. It's been said that if you want to know what your priorities are like, take a look at your checkbook or the credit card statement that you get in the mail each month. And we might add, or I might add, look at the pages of your calendar. Do these two diaries reveal or reflect a generous spirit, a generous attitude? You see, if you have given your heart first to the Lord, as the Macedonian believers did, let me tell you, the evidence will be unmistakable. Generosity will flow out, whether it is financially, whether it is with your time or your talent, it will flow out of your life. Second, when a ministry constantly gives of itself generously to the people for their spiritual growth, it calls for generous giving in response from those who receive. When a ministry consistently gives itself generously to the people for their spiritual growth, it calls for generous giving in response from the people who receive. You see, the women responded to Jesus' overflowing ministry in their lives with contributions, the scripture says, simply out of their own means. The various ministries, you see, that the Lord uses to meet our needs are the ministries that deserve our greatest support. Thirdly, when we meet pressing needs outside our own by releasing our funds, it is a learned trait. Let me give it to you again. When we meet pressing needs outside our own by releasing our funds, it is a learned trait. The more we give, the more comfortable we feel giving. The more comfortable we feel, the more joy we experience. The more joy we experience, guess what? The more we give. You see, generosity can be habit forming. You see, that's why Jesus said it is more blessed to give than to receive. That's why Jesus said, freely you have received, freely give. You see, God intends us to be open channels of his benefits. And did you know that God was a giver? Did you know that God was a great giver? Of course he was. John 3:16, the verse under which I was saved. For God so loved the world that he gave, there's the giving, he gave his one and only Son, that whosoever believeth on him shall not perish but have eternal life, everlasting life. And if you have never come to a point in your life where you have trusted in Jesus Christ, where you have received the indescribable gift of God, salvation full and free, then I suggest today that you come to the foot of the cross, that you acknowledge that you are a sinner, that you have fallen short of God's glory, that you repent and believing that Jesus Christ was crucified in your place, took your place, took your punishment, and was buried and on the third day rose again, the scripture says you will be saved. And you will discover that when you place your faith in Jesus, that that faith will take you where you have never, ever been before. But it all begins with full surrender. Full surrender. Give your life to Christ, and please listen to this closing song, reflect upon the words, and rejoice in the great gift that God has given you. Amen and amen.
I surrender, Lord, I give.
Thank you for tuning in with Pastor Ross Graham. And for more information about his ministry, visit www.gracebiblechurchkingswood.org. Until next time, God bless.